time?
15.
Oh, okay.
15. Hello, everyone. Thank you for coming. It's a pleasure to have here today Dr. Alex Bronstein, who is an associate professor in the School of Electrical Engineering at the University of Tel Aviv, and also a visiting professor at Duke in the Department of Electrical Engineering as well, and a senior research scientist at Intel Corporation. I've known actually Dr. Bronstein for many, many years. He's very well known in the area of vision, and in particular in 3D vision. And he's not only a very accomplished and illustrious researcher in the area, he's also quite an entrepreneur. He's successfully started at least one company, right? And Intel acquired him. So it's a pleasure to have him here to talk to us about some of his recent work. Thank you for coming.
Thank you for the invitation. Thanks. So what I would like to show today is quite outside of my normal scope of research. So this is a problem that has been puzzling me for quite a few time. Basically, I will show you some elementary analysis of a very well-known problem. And if you have any destructive critique, please don't be afraid and just tell me that it's uninteresting or trivial or wrong or whatever. Okay, so I will show some elementary algebra. Hopefully, it will be easy to follow. As a motivation, I would like to show things that are more my sort of cup of tea. Imagine that you have two domains like these two deformable shapes. So you have two geometries, in this case, two-dimensional manifolds embedded in the Euclidean space, and you would like to find correspondence between these two shapes. And correspondence problem is a primitive in so many computer vision and computational geometry tasks. Like, for example, if you want to attach some attributes to this shape, like, for example, if you want to paint a texture on it, and then you want to animate it or to attach texture to some 3D video that you acquire with a 3D camera, you must go through this primitive in one way or the other. So you must find correspondence between points on one manifold and map them to the two points on the other manifold. And of course, this is just an illustration. You can find problems like that in many other fields. Like, for example, you can take neuroscience, where people try to create correspondences between brain networks of different subjects. So you want essentially to find structure-preserving correspondences. I would like to find, let's say, in the simplest setting, a bijection, a one-to-one map between one domain and another that preserves, in the best possible way, some sort of structure. Okay, so this is the general setting. And one of the ways, just to put things concretely, let's say I equip this shape with a distance, so I can think of it as a metric space. I have a metric space x with a metric dx, and another metric space y with a metric dy, and I would like to find a map phi that maps x into y, such that, for example, the pairwise distances under this map are preserved as much as possible. Okay? And actually, I spent quite a few years on trying to study these problems and develop computational algorithms that will be able to solve them. So there is actually a whole, probably a wealth of literature in the past 15 years on how to do it. Basically, different ways, not only approaching how to solve this problem, but also how to represent such maps. And there are very beautiful works on this. But essentially, if you discretize these domains, you can think of this problem as matching two graphs. And this is basically what I would like to talk about. So again, this is thinking in terms of graphs and in terms of discrete spaces is quite unnatural to me. But still, I think that I hopefully will show you something interesting. So probably people in graph theory will object this abuse of notation, but the applied community refers to these problems as graph matching. or probably the most the more appropriate term would be graph isomorphism problems. So let's say I have these two graphs, same number of vertices, they are numbered differently, and here it's probably difficult to see that actually you can color the vertices in a consistent way that the adjacencies will be the same. I'm just renumbering the vertices of the graph. So these two graphs are isomorphic. There is a one-to-one map that preserves their adjacency structure. Okay. So what I will be assuming that I will be assuming weighted graphs, because remember that to me graphs are just discrete representations of metric spaces. So I can think of my adjacency metrics as a distance function, for example, or a sampled pairwise distance matrix. So these will be two undirected graphs with weighted weights on the edges, and I will simply represent them as two adjacency matrices A and B. Okay. And then let's distinguish between the following three problems. And again, this is a little bit of an abuse of the common notation in graph theory. So the graph isomorphism to me will be simply to determine whether A and B are isomorphic or not. Then I will call the exact graph matching problem is actually to find an isomorphism that relates between A and B, and it must necessarily be unique. We'll see that if graphs have symmetries, if they have non-trivial automorphism groups, then there will be more than one isomorphism relating between A and B. And this is actually, these are the cases where the problem becomes complicated. And then you might have, like in any real practical application, A and B might not be necessarily perfectly isomorphic, but there might be almost isomorphic. So the inexact version of this problem will actually ask the same question about finding the minimum distortion correspondence, while there might be some acceptable distortion. Okay? And of course, please interrupt me if you have any questions. Okay, so with this setting, I can actually formulate my problem as finding a permutation between two vertex sets of the graph. Or alternatively, I can think of my permutation as an n by n permutation matrix. So a permutation matrix is a matrix that has linearly independent rows and columns, and each row and column is just one of the standard vectors of the Euclidean basis. So basically it is orthogonal, it sums to, its columns sum to one, its rows sum to one, and I can write my pursuit of the best structure preserving transformation as this optimization problem. So I'm trying to find a permutation matrix such that it permutes the vertices of the graph, let's say B. It means that I need to multiply by this matrix from both sides, the adjacency matrix B. And I would like to match this permuted adjacency matrix to the matrix A of the other graph as closely as possible, in the sense of minimizing some norm. Okay? And the optimization will be performed over the space of permutation matrices, which is, of course, a horrible optimization problem, because it will be combinatorial. Actually, this is a funny problem, because it is known to be NP, but it is not known to be NP complete. And on the other hand, no polynomial time algorithm is known, at least in the general case, for general graphs. Though there are many types of graphs where linear or polynomial time algorithms are known. And one of the examples, of course, or actually I will give two examples, bipartite graphs can be matched using linear programming or using Hungarian algorithms. And trees, of course, can also be matched in linear time. But for other graphs, there are more results, and probably there are books written on this problem, but all of them boil down to impractical algorithms, with even if linear time or slightly more than linear time, the constants are prohibitively large. So what I will be doing, I will try to address a very popular heuristic that people use in practice to solve this problem, which solves the convex relaxation. Okay. So basically, if I take the L2 norm here, because the permutation is an orthogonal transformation, and the L2 norm is invariant orthogonal transformation, I can actually put this pi on the other side. Okay, so I have this objective. And then, again, what makes my problem so complicated is this space of permutations that I need to solve the optimization problem on. I will relax it to the convex hull of the permutation matrices. And the convex hull, which is called the Birkhoff polytop, it is basically the space of doubly stochastic matrices. Okay, so the vertices of this polytop are exactly permutation matrices. But basically, I'm also taking all the interior of this polytop, and these are exactly these matrices. They have no negative elements. Yes, please.
Generally speaking, it's unknown. It's an open problem insofar as characterizing space permutation matrices. Do we know anything about the structure of this space at all?
No. I think it's well studied. So basically,
the space itself.
The space itself is well known, but solving optimization problems on this space is very difficult in general. Basically, you have n factorial elements, and they are discrete, so it's a combinatorial optimization problem. But convex relaxation, you have a convex objective. If you replace the space of permutations by this space of doubly stochastic matrices, which is the tightest, the smallest convex set that contains all permutations, you get a nice quadratic program. And of course, quadratic programs can be solved in polynomial time. Actually, there are very efficient solvers for quadratic programs. So I would, and this is what people do, actually. There are works on human connectome data, basically on brain networks, containing very large graphs, solved very efficiently using these sort of relaxations. And actually, the common wisdom, at least what I know and I hear from application people, they're telling that this works very well. Convex relaxation works very well. So to me, it is intriguing and thought-provoking to see a heuristic that works well. And I think it is almost imperative to try to understand why and when it fails and how to fix it. So this is what I will show, just probably a tiny bit of results and some directions that I think might be interesting in trying to better understand this problem. Like, for example, why are we choosing this convex space? Is it the right convex space? Maybe we can relax more and get a better optimization problem that is easier to solve. So I think there are many questions that have to be asked here that are largely unanswered. And I tried approaching many graph theorists. Probably I was approaching the wrong people, but at least I was frustrated by the lack of answers that they were able to provide. So that's why I eventually found time to try gaining some understanding of these problems. So I hope it will be interesting today. Okay, so I will be looking at this relaxation. Of course, the problem with convex relaxations in general, and this convex relaxation in particular, is that if you take the minimizer of this problem, it will not be a permutation matrix in general. So I will call this solution by P star, and P star usually is not a permutation. So what usually is done, you need to quantize your relaxed solution back onto the space of the permutation. You need to project it. And one of the ways to do this projection is to basically, it's like orthogonal projection, right? You want to maximize the inner product between your solution pi star and a permutation, one of the permutations in this space of n by n permutations. And actually, this is a very simple problem, because this is a linear objective, so you can write it like this. You maximize this trace. Actually, it is known as linear assignment problem, and it can be solved either using linear programming or using a family of techniques known as Hungarian algorithm. It is solved in polynomial time. Okay, so basically, the relaxation works like this. You first solve this quadratic program, and then you do the projection. And actually, there are a few recent papers, like the path-following paper by Francis Bach, that actually they try to do better this step. So relaxation can actually improve and can be applicable to a wider class of problems when you do this better. But again, there is no really theoretical understanding when it will fail and when it will work. Okay, but I will stick to this very simple form of projection, and I'm just saying that there are ways to do it better. Okay, any questions? Okay, so basically the question I would like essentially to answer with some variants is, what is the relation between pi star and pi hat, which is the result of the projection of the solution of the convex relaxation? Okay, and obviously pi star is a solution of the relaxation, right? Because if you plug in pi star, you will get zero objective, and you cannot get smaller than zero. So pi star is the solution. The other way around is not true. You might have some p star, the solution of the relaxation, that unfortunately by some game of chance will fall into the wrong Voronoi cell in the space of permutations. And then when you project, you will get a permutation that is not an isomorphism. Okay? And then, of course, it might depend on the initialization of your optimization algorithm, on the exact algorithm that you're using. But basically, the other way around is not true. That's why convex relaxations sometimes don't work. And at least, as far as I know, there is not so much known about the relation between pi star, which is the global minimizer or a global minimizer of the unrelaxed problem, which is NP, but not known to be either NP hard or solved in polynomial time, and pi hat, which is the projection of the solution of the relaxation. Okay? So I would like to consider a more relaxed version of the convex relaxation, so a wider relaxation, and I will try to convince you that it still works well. So instead of considering this space of doubly stochastic matrices, so doubly stochastic matrices means that you have non-negative entries, rows sum to one, columns sum to one. Okay? So I would like to drop some constraints. I will drop non-negativity constraints, so I might have negative entries, and I will drop, let's say, the column sum constraints. So basically, I will call these matrices pseudo-stochastic. If they had non-negative entries, this would be just a stochastic matrix. You can think of it as, for example, transition probability matrix in a Markov chain. But I'm also dropping the non-negativity constraints. And actually, the structure of the problem changes quite significantly. Here, we have overlapping constraints. So these constraints, each of them involves each row of the matrix, and here you involve each column of the matrix. So you have overlaps between optimization variables, and here you also need to impose non-negativity, which really complicates the algorithms that you use to solve quadratic programs. Now here you decouple the constraints. They are not overlapping anymore. So you can theoretically optimize in groups of variables, and you also don't have non-negativity, which usually, at least, I haven't explored this to any direction, but usually this means that probably some more efficient optimization algorithms can be devised here if you stick with this relaxation. Okay? So this is the convex relaxation I'm going to consider. Again, it's convex. The set of constraints is convex. It's linear. The objective is convex. Okay? And for these problems, I would like to define the following quite wide family of graphs. I will call them friendly. So the friendly graphs will be characterized by the following spectral characteristics. So first of all, I want A to have simple spectrum. So there will be no multiplicities, no non-trivial multiplicities of the eigenvalues. And then another funny condition, I would like the eigenvectors, so none of the eigenvectors, to be orthogonal to a vector of basically a constant vector of ones. Okay, so this means, for example, that no regular graph is included in this family, because regular graphs are known to have a constant eigenvector. Okay? And actually, I don't want to get into arguments about random graphs, because probably we will be unable to agree what is the nature of distribution of random graphs. But if you take, I would conjecture, a reasonable distribution of graphs, you can say that with probability 1, they will be friendly, because unfriendly graphs are sort of a singular property. And also, if you take any graph and you perturb it with any reasonable distribution of noise in the adjacency matrix, it will become friendly. Well, because basically, degenerate spectrum or non-trivial multiplicities is a singular property. It usually basically concentrates it with measure zero, let's put it this way. Okay, so I'm considering this family of friendly graphs. And again, just to emphasize, when I'm talking about spectral properties, I'm not talking about properties of the Laplacian of the graph, which is usually what graph theorists understand by spectral properties. I'm talking about the spectrum of the adjacency matrix itself, which to me is a bit unfortunate, because eventually I would like to connect this to the properties of the manifold, for example, from which I sampled my graph. And manifolds are easily characterized by using spectral properties of the Laplace-Beltrami operator, which is the continuous version of the graph Laplacian. And here there is no direct connection to that object. Okay, so this will be my family of graphs, and I will show, first of all, a very trivial property, that friendly graphs are asymmetric. And by asymmetric, I mean that they have trivial self-isomorphisms or trivial automorphism group. Okay, and this is very easy to show. Just bear with me, it's a trivial property. So let's assume that A admits this orthogonal eigendecomposition. It's a symmetric matrix, so it has orthogonal, it is diagonalized by an orthogonal matrix, which I will call U, and it has real spectrum. Okay? So then let's assume that we have some non-trivial permutation to which A is invariant. Okay, so pi is an automorphism of the graph A. Okay, so this means that, well, first of all, because of this, so I can write this eigendecomposition for every I, A times ui equals lambda I ui, right? This is just a way to say that ui and lambda I are eigenvectors and corresponding eigenvalues of A. Okay, but I can now substitute this result. A is equal to pi A, right? Because pi is an automorphism. And I can, I will just multiply multiply it by pi from the left. So pi A will be equal pi U, right? But because A is an automorphism, pi A and A pi, they commute, right? So pi and A commute. And I will write A pi here, okay? But this means that pi ui is an eigenvector of A corresponding to lambda I, okay? But we just claim that A was friendly. So friendliness means that it has simple spectrum. If it has simple spectrum, this means that lambda I cannot have non-trivial multiplicity. So this means that pi ui and ui must be linearly dependent. And because I'm assuming that eigenvectors have unit lengths and pi is an isometry, it doesn't change length, this means that pi ui is either plus ui or minus ui. There is no other possibility. Okay? Now, because we assume that pi is non-trivial, there must be some ui for which pi ui equals minus ui. If this is not true, then pi is simply the identity matrix, right? Because the eigenvectors span the entire Rn. Now, if this is true, well, I can multiply everything by a constant vector of 1s from the left, so I get 1 inner product pi ui equals minus 1 inner product ui, okay? On the other hand, pi is a permutation matrix, so its columns sum to 1, okay? If I multiply this by ui, I get 1 transpose pi ui equals 1 transpose ui. Now, combining these two results, of course, I get that inner product of ui with 1 equals 0, but this contradicts the assumption of friendliness that I just made, okay? So basically, this funny property of not being orthogonal to the constant vector actually prevents from my graph to be symmetric, okay? And the other way around is not true. So it is not true that, so basically this means that you can find graphs that are unfriendly but are still asymmetric. So this class is more narrow than the class of asymmetric graphs. You can think of graphs that are regular, which violate this property, but are still asymmetric. And a forked graph, for example, I think 12 vertices is the minimum number you can find such graphs. But I'm claiming that they are rare, again, going back to my previous argument. Okay? Questions? Okay, so basically, with this premise, with this characterization of the space of graphs, I would like to make the following statement. I'm saying that if A and B are friendly isomorphic graphs, then the convex relaxation will give me the exact isomorphism. Okay, so I can say the exact isomorphism because they are asymmetric and the isomorphism is unique. Okay? So basically, in this case, I don't even need to do the projection. If I do the projection, of course, I will get the same result because the convex relaxation already gives me a permutation matrix. Okay. So let's see quickly how to prove this result. Actually, it is absolutely elementary. Before that, I just want to make I want to remark on this theorem. Basically, a condition tells that the graphs need to be isomorphic, but checking this condition, of course, is hard. That's why we are solving the relaxation, in order not to check isomorphism directly. But what I can do in practice is the following. I can check for friendliness, and if I have that the graphs are friendly, I will just solve the relaxation. If I solve the relaxation and I get objective equals zero, the theorem guarantees me that what I got is an exact isomorphism. And basically, it guarantees me that I have a permutation matrix. Now, if I didn't get a solution that has objective zero, so it has non-zero distortion, then the theorem guarantees me that the graphs cannot be isomorphic. Okay? Okay, so let's see how to show these results. So I'm assuming that I have two friendly graphs, B and A is related to B by this isomorphism pi star, which of course I don't know. Okay, and I want to find. And this is the convex quadratic program that I want to solve. You see, it is over-relaxed. I'm throwing the non-negativity constraints and the column sum constraints. So these are my, what I call, pseudo-stochastic matrices. And I want to show, so first of all, it has a global minimizer at pi star, right? If you plug in pi star here, you will see that the objective will be zero. I want to show that this minimizer is unique. Or in other words, that the optimality conditions of this problem will be full rank. Now, I want to reparameterize. I want to get rid of A and B. I want to work with just one of these matrices. So imagine that I can claim without loss of generality, somebody gave me A and B with consistently numbered vertices. So I need to show that I can recover this identity matrix as my only isomorphism. So basically, I can do it formally by doing the following. I can substitute, first of all, A in this form here. And then because the L2 norm is invariant to orthogonal transformations, I will simply multiply by pi star transpose here and get this. Okay? Now, because of this particular type of constraints, the right-hand side is a vector of ones. I can reorder them in any order. So multiplying this by any permutation will not change the constraint set. So I can write it like this. Okay? Now, just call this P pi star transpose a new matrix Q. It is also a pseudo-stochastic matrix. I just reorder its entries. And I need to show that this global minimizer Q equals identity is unique. Okay? So let's have a closer look at this problem. Basically, now it's standard, I think, probably calculus 1 or something like that. It's constrained minimization. First-order optimality condition tell me that there exists a vector of n Lagrange multipliers, I will call them alpha, such that the gradient of the Lagrangian with respect to Q vanishes at the solution. Okay? So if I take the gradient, just trivial calculus will give me Q B squared plus B squared Q minus twice B Q B plus alpha 1 transpose. And I'm using the property that B is symmetric, of course. So now I can rearrange this a little bit. So I would like to express this system of n by n equations in the eigenbasis of the adjacency matrix B. Okay, so I will assume that B admits this eigendecomposition U lambda U transpose. Okay, and well, some simple manipulations. I substitute it here, multiply by U transpose from the left, U from the right, and I get this. Okay. Now, I will just call this matrix, my solution, transform into the eigenbasis of B. I will call it F. This will be the Lagrange multipliers expressed in the eigenbasis of B. I will call it gamma. And this, pay attention here, this is the projection of my eigenvectors onto the constant vector. I will call it V. Okay, so this is the system that I got. And remember, the graphs are friendly, so this vector have no zero entries. Okay, this will be important. So now you see, you have a full square here. So let's write it in coordinates. In coordinates, it will look like this. I have Fij multiplied by the difference of the lambda squared plus Vj gamma I equals 0. Okay? Now, if I look at the diagonal of this system for I equals j, I have Vi, so this will vanish, of course, Vi gamma I equals 0. Now, because of the Vi's, none of the Vi's is 0, this means that gamma is 0. Okay? So I can eliminate this second term completely, and I get this system of equations. Okay? And of course, it becomes trivial on the diagonal, so I only care about the non-diagonal elements. Okay? Now, because of friendliness, for every I distinct from j, this is non-zero. Okay? So if this is non-zero, f must be diagonal, right? So if f is diagonal, and I now put another condition that I know, Q is a stochastic matrix, right? So its rows have to sum to 1. So 1 equals Q1, I can substitute the form for Q, and this gives me that U transpose 1 equals F U transpose 1, which is the same as saying that FV equals V. And V's are all non-zeros. So the only way this can hold is if F is identity. Now, if F is identity, obviously Q is identity. And this is what I was trying to prove. Basically, it means that I have a full rank system here. Its only solution is the identity matrix. Okay? Questions so far? As I promised, this is a completely elementary proof. Now, with very little leap of analysis, but with some more elaborate details, I can say that I want to do perturbation analysis on this result and show that this result is stable. So for this, I will need to slightly complicate my assumption. So instead of friendly graphs, I will require this property to be satisfied in a stronger way. So instead of having simple spectrum, I will require some spectral gap that I will call delta, and I will require that this property is satisfied with some epsilon, some margin epsilon. Okay, so then I can prove using classical first order non-degenerate or regular perturbation analysis of linear systems of equations, basically, that if I perturb one of my matrices, A or B, then the system of equations that I showed you will remain regular and remain full rank. Okay? So basically, I can say that A and B are strongly friendly graphs that I assume that they are raw isomorphic. And by raw isomorphic, I mean that basically there exists a permutation such that this distortion of the adjacencies is no bigger than rho, okay? So then, depending on this epsilon and delta, and also the size of the graph, if I can bound rho, I can guarantee that the permutation, that the solution of the relaxation will be no farther in the L infinity norm than the exact isomorphism. Okay, so basically it means, just try to visualize it, this was my, well, I draw it as a convex space. Actually, I have an affine space because the way I relaxed my problem. But just imagine that this was my permutation matrix. This was a vertex of this polytop. Actually, it's an unbounded affine space. This was my P star, let's call it P star 0, of the case where A and B were exactly isomorphic, and actually coincided with pi star. Okay, so now I'm introducing noise to my adjacency matrices, and as a result, the solution moves to another point. Right, this is my new p star. Okay, but I can tell you that even if you don't do the projection the way I did, even if you just quantize your solution by saying that whatever is smaller than 1/2 goes to 0, whatever is bigger than 1/2 goes to 1, if I guarantee that none of the coordinates of this p star is moved by more than 1/2, then basically the projection will give me back this vertex, right? So this is exactly what I'm showing here, and There is some bound, you can find it explicitly. I find it strikingly uninsightful, maybe, so that's why I'm not showing it. But it will depend on delta, on epsilon, the size of the graph. But eventually, if you can bound your perturbation, the solution, the perturbation and the solution can also be bounded by, in the sense of this L infinity norm. This means that after projection, you get the same exact isomorphism. Okay, so basically it means that under this slightly stronger assumption, the result that I showed you before is stable. Okay? Any questions so far? So at least until now, this shows some extent of applicability of the convex relaxation, right? So you can actually check that you can solve this, you can solve strong, or you can check strong friendliness, solve the relaxation. If you find that your solution is below that bound, then you are guaranteed to have found the best, the globally optimal approximate isomorphism. Actually, strong friendliness also means that it's unique. Otherwise, you have a guarantee that the graphs cannot be raw isomorphic, so they are more distinct than raw. Okay, same story as we had in the exact version of this theorem. And actually, I will show you an empirical result. So I randomized here 1,000 different graphs of different sizes. All of them are strongly friendly, but with different values of epsilon and delta. And then basically for each graph, I randomized multiple versions of noise. I don't remember how many. And just to be able to show everything on a single plot, basically I'm normalizing the magnitude of the noise by this bound rho. So noise of 1 means that I'm exactly at the bound. And you can see that, well, obviously, you are expecting to see some sort of a transition diagram, like, for example, people in sparse modeling or compressed sensing like to show. Basically, if you are below this bound, unless you had a bug in the proof, basically, all your attempts to solve the convex relaxation will give you the exact solution. And this is exactly what is happening here. Now, when you are adding more noise, probably the chances to get the exact isomorphism become lower and lower, and actually starting from a certain amount of noise you can not trust your ground truth anymore, because you might have created a better isomorphism. There is no way to know that, because in order to know that you need to enumerate all the possible isomorphisms, but this we know that there is no known polynomial time algorithm for that. So basically I cannot tell what happens for very strong noise, so at least you will not, the probability of getting at least that ground truth isomorphism pi star goes to zero very fast.
That bound will depend on the graph, right?
It depends on the graph. So it depends on these two constant epsilon and delta, and also the size.
The complexity of the graph.
Well, so you can think of it as sort of complexity. So unfortunately, I have no clue how to connect these spectral properties to the combinatorial properties of the graph. So I probably can give you some trivial counter examples, like it cannot be regular or things like that, or it cannot be symmetric. But I don't have any better connection than this. And this is one of the things that I tried asking graph theory people, and they don't know either, at least apparently. But surprisingly, so we had such a crude analysis here, and apparently it looks like, I'm not claiming that this is a tight bound. I have no idea how to prove that. But it looks like there will be some directions that will, with some probability, violate cause the convex relaxation to fail if you exceed this bound by quite a tiny amount of noise, which is, to me, is quite surprising. So it's not tight, but at least empirically on these graphs, it looks like quite to be close to be tight. Okay? Any questions? Okay, so I would like to actually to try to address a slightly more interesting, I have 10 minutes, I think, or something. Okay. A slightly more interesting case where basically the graphs are not friendly. So for friendly graphs, we have some results that show that the convex relaxation works. But what happens for unfriendly graphs? So for unfriendly graphs, let's just put some notation. I'm assuming that I have, let's say, D non-simple eigenspaces. Each of them will be of dimension mi plus 1. So let's say the first m1 plus 1 eigenvalues will be the same. Then I will have another space of non-simple m2 plus 1 eigenvalues and so on. Okay? And I will sum these m1, m2 and up to md into a single value that I will call m. So if the graph has simple spectrum, m will be 0. This is sort of an excess of non-simplicity of the eigenspaces, if you allow me to call it this way. So it tells me how non-simple is the spectrum of my graph. Now, because I now have non-simple eigenspaces, there is no unique way to define eigenvectors. Actually, they're defined only up to rotation and reflection. So before I had just sign ambiguity, now I have ambiguity up to rotation. So then it might happen to me that, so this is, suppose this is my eigenspace, two-dimensional eigenspace, and let's say this is my constant vector of ones. By some chance, I might select one of the eigenvectors spanning this eigenspace orthogonal to this vector. Okay? So let's agree, let's establish a convention. I will always make sure that this never happens unless the vector of ones is orthogonal to the entire space. Okay? Otherwise, I can always select an eigenbasis that none of the vectors will be orthogonal to the vector of ones. Okay? So then I can distinguish between two cases. For each eigenspace, I can either have none of the eigenvectors orthogonal to 1, and I will call such space non-hostile, and the other case will be a hostile eigenspace. So those eigenvectors are all orthogonal to the vector of 1s. Okay, so they violate the second friendliness assumption. So I will call k the number of hostile eigenspaces, and we can think of m plus k the sort of unfriendliness degree of the graph. If this quantity equals 0, then I have a friendly graph. Okay? And actually, there is no simple way to connect this friendliness degree to the number of symmetries, but you can kind of think of that the more symmetries the graph has, the bigger will be this degree. Actually, you can probably put some Laws upper bound. So you can say that if you have a certain multiplicity of the eigenspaces in the graph, then you can put some upper bound of the number of generators of the symmetry group or something like that. But the other way is more difficult. And I don't know how k, actually. Somehow k appears, k grows when the number of symmetries grows, but I don't know why, and I don't know how to quantify that. So there are some symmetries, like reflection symmetries, that don't influence m, but they necessarily create non-zero k. Okay, so let's get back to our first-order optimality condition. So we have these two conditions. We have this first-order optimality condition plus the stochasticity constraint that we imposed. And I'm already writing this in the form that we used before with the matrix F, which, I remind you, represents the solution of the isomorphism problem in the eigenbasis of the adjacency matrix. Okay? So I can actually write this system of equations considering each row of the matrix F independently. So I have n systems with n plus 1 equations and n plus 1 variables, y n plus 1. So here I have n variables plus 1 variable, the Lagrange multiplier. I have n equations here plus 1 equation here. Okay? So it's n plus 1 by n plus 1. Now, I will have one trivial equation here because the lambdas will vanish. But because now I'm assuming that I have m plus 1 multiplicity here, right? So mi plus 1 equations will disappear. I have basically a block of zeros here. And the rest of the equations are linearly independent because of the diagonal structure of the matrix. So basically I have, so the case I have non-hostile eigenspace, actually I can solve. So because vi is distinct from 0, I can solve for gamma. So I eliminate this degree of freedom. And basically gamma will be 0. And basically, this means that I'm only missing MI equations. So this means that my system is rank MI deficient. I'm missing MI equations, and this is basically the dimension of my solution space. Now, in case of hostile eigenspaces, basically, gamma cannot be determined either. So I have one more rank deficiency. So in this case, the system will be MI plus one deficient. Okay? So if I sum everything, it's easy, so easy to see that the rank deficiency was created by the excess of multiplicity, MI, and by K. Okay? So basically, the entire system will be rank M plus K deficient. So this degree of unfriendliness exactly tells me how many dimensions I'm going to have in my solution space. Okay? And because the solution space is no more zero-dimensional, I can have basically a lot of solutions. And some of them might fall into wrong Voronoi cells, be quantized into a wrong permutation, and eventually I get something that is not an isomorphism, though the graphs are isomorphic, because they are not friendly. And actually, one non-constructive thing to say, I can say that actually for a sufficiently big M plus K, this will necessarily happen. You can prove this result, but it's useless. This simply tells that convex relaxation is not applicable to such cases. But actually, I will try in the 5 minutes that remain, I will try to show that you can still do something very, very simple here and make the problem work. So I will need to add some side information. And basically, in practice, people use this side information all the time. So either by adding seeds into the graph matching problem, and seeds are knowingly corresponding vertices, or not necessarily vertices, basically knowingly corresponding sets of vertices or functions on the two graphs. So you can think that I have one graph, and I have another graph, and I'm telling you that this vertex is known to map to this vertex, okay? And this obviously has to simplify the matching problem, because some of the correspondences are already established. And I can generalize it. I can say that I have some set of Q functions, C1 to CQ. So these are, I can think of them as n-dimensional vectors. Basically, these are real functions on the vertices of my graph A. And I have corresponding functions on the other graph. So I will call them D. So I have two matrices, C and D. Their columns are corresponding functions. Okay? I will assume that they are covariant with some preferred isomorphism pi star, because I have more than one isomorphism now, because the graphs are unfriendly. Okay, so I have some preferred isomorphism that I selected when I defined these correspondences. I'm assuming that all of them are consistent. So basically, the columns of C and pi star D are representing corresponding functions. And I can alternatively think of the rows of these matrices C and D as q-dimensional vector attributes that I'm attaching to each vertex. Okay, so you can think of it either way. I'm either doing attributed graph matching or I'm doing seeded graph matching. So basically, algebraically, they are completely equivalent. These are two equivalent problems. And then rows of C and pi star D will be corresponding attributes. Okay? So now I will go back to my relaxation and I will add this term that penalizes for the disagreement of my seeds or attributes in the matching. Okay? So this is a relaxed version of seeded or attributed matching. And you can think of this either as penalty of the attribute disagreement or penalty on seeds, the seed on correspondence between the seeds. Usually this is put as a hard constraint, but think of it as a soft constraint version of seeded matching. Okay? Any questions? Okay, so I will show you some ugly result, but just ignore the conditions for a second. Basically, I'm saying that if A and B are isomorphic graphs, unfriendly in general, and I have C and D, two sets of, let's call them seeds, or you can think of them as attributes if you want, they are consistent with some isomorphism of the two graphs, and they have more than one, then if these seeds satisfy some set of conditions, then the convex relaxation is guaranteed to produce a unique solution, which is will be which is exactly pi star for any positive mu. Okay, so let's ignore these conditions for a second. Let's just see why it happens. Going back to the proof that I showed for the very first result. So now I have this new quadratic program with the global minimizer pi star. Again, I reparameterize it in terms of Q. I need to show that Q is unique. Q equals identity is unique. Okay. So I got back my first order optimality conditions, but now I have these new two terms that depend on mu and depend on d transpose. Okay, so you can think of d transpose as the Gramian matrix of the attributes, if you wish. Okay. So let's now transform everything to the eigen basis of the adjacency matrix as we did before. So these are my first order optimality conditions, and now f will also participate in this linear term. So f multiplied by g. G is that Gramian matrix in the eigenbasis of the adjacency matrix. Okay? But g is positive semi-definite. So it can only increase the rank of this system. Okay? It will never decrease the rank of this system. It can only increase it. And actually, those conditions that we had before are just conditions guaranteeing that this system will become full rank. So there is no magic there. And actually, these conditions are constructive. And you can apply them in an adaptive way. So you selected a seed. How about selecting the next seed? So first of all, they tell you when to stop adding seeds, right? You know ahead of time what is the minimum number of seeds that will give you a theoretical guarantee that the relaxation will work. Now, if I added a seed, maybe adding another seed will not give you anything because it will not disambiguate another symmetry. So these conditions tell you how not to choose certain seeds that will not give you additional information. Okay, so I didn't explore this in depth, but I think there is something interesting here. Maybe doing some smart algorithms for adaptive selection of seeds. Like if you go back to this neuroscience application, marking manually every point costs you money. So can you decide ahead of time which points to mark and to make sure that your graph matching task will work afterwards. Okay. So this is just a visualization of what I showed you before in a real experiment. So these are graphs with different number of symmetries, and these are all, of course, unfriendly graphs. And what I'm putting on the horizontal axis is the ratio between the number of seeds satisfying these conditions to the number of symmetries in the graph. Zero means that this is an unseeded version of the convex relaxation, and you can see that the probability of it to succeed is very low because many times you are falling into the wrong Voronoi cell. And when, so here, these conditions tell you how many seeds you need. So when you put all of them with probability one, at least on that set of graphs, you get the right result. So this is just to corroborate this theoretical result. Now, I think I ran out of time, probably by just a bit. So I would like to conclude with a few questions which I think are more interesting than what I showed before. So first of all, I think what is quite remarkable about these three theorems is that we didn't really use all the constraints that people normally use to relax graph matching problems. So we dropped the non-negativity constraints. How important are they? And we also dropped the second set of overlapping equality constraints. There must be some practical implications on the complexity of the optimization problem, but it means that probably you can overrelax this problem without harm. Or actually understanding when you need these constraints looks like an important problem. Also, we didn't make any use of geometry, like assuming that the adjacency matrix, for example, came from a low-dimensional matrix space, maybe with bounded curvature, something like that. Can this help? Can this help to alleviate the computational burden of this problem? Maybe extend the domain of graphs to which the relaxation will become applicable. Now, along the line of what I showed in results 2 and 3, and I think this is the most interesting part. So we added. Some side information in order to make the system full rank. Can you actually modify the adjacency matrix itself to make the system full rank. So think of it like breaking the symmetry by adding some particularly structured low rank noise only to those eigenspaces of the adjacency matrix that cause all the trouble, that are unfriendly. Can you make this noise? Will the relaxation still work? And this somehow resembles the results that were shown in the 90s about linear programming. So in linear programming, the simplex algorithm is known to be a very efficient heuristic. It converges very fast, though its theoretical complexity is non-polynomial. There are some examples on which it takes exponential time to run. But what Dan Spielmann showed in the 90s by, basically this was a revolution, I think, in complexity theory, he actually showed that if you take those corner cases, those worst cases on which it takes simplex to an exponential time to converge, and you do a random perturbation to those problems, then with very high probability you will get again a polynomial time algorithm. So maybe the same story happens here, because convex relaxation works well in practice. So maybe those corner cases, those unfriendly cases, can be actually made friendly again by some controlled perturbation of the adjacency. I think I have the feeling that this is the case, but I still didn't have any chance to think how to prove it. And then one more problem that is interesting in many practical applications, probably in computational chemistry, is how to find all the isomorphisms. So let's say you have a molecule, how to find all the symmetries, for example, all the self-isomorphisms of that graph. And this doesn't require, this basically requires more than just finding a solution, it requires to enumerate all the solutions that you have in the isomorphism group. Okay? So I think I will stop here. Thank you for your attention.
It is a very interesting topic. So I was wondering that it seems that we can directly apply the result to similarity matrix instead of adjacency matrix. Am I correct?
So similarity matrix?
Yes. For example, we're not just having a local information about the connections, the nodes. Instead of that, we have the global similarity matrix of all the vertices. Would it be directly?
So maybe give me some more information. So what do you mean by similarity exactly? Can you suggest an equation?
So here the adjacency matrix means that we consider the adjacent vertex.
So let's say you have a graph, right?
Right.
Or let's say you have some
metric space. Some manifold, for example. Uh-huh. To me, it's easier to think in these terms. Uh-huh. So I took a shape, let's say a two-dimensional manifold. I sampled it at a bunch of points. And then I took the geodesic distances and I put them as the weights of my, let's say I triangulated this surface and I put my, or doesn't need to be triangulated. Let's say I put all my pairwise distances as my adjacency, matrix, for example.
Yeah, yeah. So here the adjacency matrix is not necessarily sparse, right?
It may be sparse, it may be not sparse. So it is, again, it is difficult to connect the spectral properties of this matrix to combinatorial property, like the degree of a graph, for example, or the valence of a vertex. It's difficult to make these connections. It's probably easier when you talk about spectral properties of the Laplacian, but I don't know any significant results about the connection between the two.
Question? I actually I couldn't help but be intrigued a little bit by the set of results that you gave, particularly in the case where you had multiplicity of what I was asking myself is, okay, that didn't work for your whole graph. Can we further relax it and look for a subgraph?
Okay. I see. So partial similarity.
Yeah, and then the question then comes another question. Then how is that related, for instance, for the edit, you know, the graph edit type of isomorphism that some people, like Zucker and people like that, Pelillo and have worked on in the 90s and things like that.
So I showed this particular formulation of the graph isomorphism problem that looked like this, right? So I have this quadratic distortion. Of course, this is not the only formulation of the problem. This makes a lot of sense because it has an immediate geometric interpretation. So many computer vision people and probably bioinformatics people will disagree with this formulation, but computer vision people will probably agree on this. Computational geometry people will also see it very useful, but you can have a lot of other distortion criteria, like the edit distance, for example. So for the edit distance, I think there are stronger results known. There are combinatorial algorithms that work in many cases. But then it is sometimes difficult to interpret the results. I'm not sure if they even can be extended to weighted graphs.
Okay, so the other question is pertains, again, basically your relaxed optimization fails when you start having these multiple spectra. And then are there any specific characteristics that one can zero in on that cause these multiplicity?
One of the main reasons, symmetry. So one of the main reasons of having, so first of all, you have some graphs, like a regular graph will be unfriendly even if it is not. So basically, having some regular structure, let's put it this way, and it's hard for me to defend this general notion, but symmetry definitely and regularity. These are two properties, two combinatorial properties that and result in unfriendliness.
And you can't introduce that kind of sort of an iterative manner.
Well, this is what I meant here, right? So assume that I can add some noise in a very controlled manner to my matrix, in such a way that it will break all the symmetries. So let's say my unfriendliness comes from symmetry or regularity. I will add noise. Regularity is gone with probability 1. Symmetry is gone with probability 1, right? So will now the relaxation work? So I don't have an answer to this question, but I have the feeling that if you know how to add this noise in a controlled way, it should work. So it looks like all those cases where the relaxation fails, they're sort of singular, measure zero cases in the space of all possible inputs to the problem. So the problem looks simple because these heuristics really work. And that's why I find analogy to linear programming quite similar, because, so first of all, analysis tools might be similar because Spielman used perturbation theory of convex polytops. You might find it useful here as well. You have similarly structured problems. And also, he also found that those inputs that result in exponential running time have measure zero. They are basically singular examples, and you perturb it and you get polynomial runtime again. So I think similar situation might happen here as well.
Any other questions? Well, if not, it's time to speak again.
Thank you.